The statistical process control, known as the SPC, is based on regular monitoring of the process outputs. For example, in one automotive production running on three-shift basis, I was given to understand that they do the SPC always on the Tuesday's night shift by measuring 5 parts from each process. Or another one. Not a long time before that, I came across a production with 40% scrap rate due to inherent process variation, where the 100% end-of-line quality check was sorting the parts to OK and not OK. Here the production manager suggested cutting down on the measurement costs by implementing the SPC sampling instead. This made me wonder what makes people, who are otherwise quite decent, to utter such inappropriate statements and to implement such detrimental measures. Not surprisingly, the two examples were a result of the Lean Six Sigma strategy evolving into a lean brain management. My first advice is, don't let that happen to you. Well, let's see what the SPC is and how it relates to the process capability. The process capability compares the output of the process to the specification and measures the process ability to meet the specification through a range of indices like the CP, CPK, CPM, CP star, and many more. In short, if the indices are calculated properly, they express how likely will the future outcome of the process be within the specification limits. As we are trying to predict the future based upon the empirical observations, a proper statistics is inevitable. As a result, the process is either capable or not. The process stability evaluates whether the crucial process characteristics, most prominently the mean and the variation, alter only within a statistically insignificant margins. The process appears unstable when we have enough evidence to claim that either the mean or the variation is no longer what it used to be, or that some observations are statistically unlikely. Please note that this is not at all connected to the specification. The SPC is often understood as a technique suitable for looking back at the collected data and estimating if some unusual observations appeared. But this is not its purpose. The SPC, the process control, should be the technique of the actual control. It is not that interesting how unusual the process was in the past. It is much more interesting whether it is unusual right now, right at the time when one is deciding if a control intervention is needed and what intervention it should be. Looking back at the historical stability data is just a hint on how to set an appropriate control routine, both statistically and technically. Processes that demonstrate sudden changes in properties will need more robust control techniques than processes that run smoothly. In quite a few Six Sigma textbooks, you will find the imperative that the capability can only be estimated for the stable, in-control processes. This you will find, for example, in the online Engineering Statistics Handbook, published by the National Institute of Standards and Technology, part of the USA's Department of Commerce. Process capability compares the output of an in-control process to the specification limits by using capability indices. The justification of this sounds reasonable, stating that the capability checks the process's ability to meet the specification. So, is it possible to estimate the capability of a process whose outcome is unpredictable due to instability? It seems obvious that the assessment would only reflect the specific time at which the process was sampled and would not be able to infer future behavior. This justification has, however, very little practical meaning and is inconsistent with the purpose of the process control. If, for example, the mean of the process starts to shift in time due to tool wear, such process is statistically unstable, but technically, it is predictable. Since the statistical process control is aimed at controlling, not just observing, the proper SPC technique will suggest an appropriate intervention before the shift would jeopardize the specification. After all, it is possible to assess whether the complete process, consisting of the statistically unstable machine output and the controlling interventions, is able to meet the specification as a whole. In reality, the process can be any combination of capability and stability. The two are not inherently related. The sampling for the SPC has two major aspects. First, the sample size and the control limits are mostly a statistical matter. This is basically a hypothesis testing, where the alternative hypothesis states that the process characteristic has changed. As always with such testing, there can be two types of risk. Here, the alpha error is a risk of a false alarm, which can be reduced quite well by extending the control limits. On the other hand, however, the extended limits will increase the beta error, which is the risk of missing the change. It is a long-time practice to set the alpha error to 0.27%, a complement to plus minus 3 sigma in a normal distribution, and to balance the beta error with the sample size, based on the previously observed properties. The usage of the previously observed data is a must. We cannot rely on the theoretical variation based on the demanded process capability. Clearly, making a universal standard for the sample size does not make sense. Whatever standard number would be chosen, it would be too little for some processes, and we would miss the chance to control them, and too high for the others, where we would be wasting money with unnecessary measurements. In such a case, testing the 5 pieces on the Tuesday's night shift may be sufficient. The second aspect, the sampling period, is more or less a manufacturing and technical competency. It more or less sums up to how long we can let the adjusted process go before it threatens to develop a specification-breaching change. It is not risk-free, just like the hypothesis testing, but what is? One way of dealing with this is to assess the machine capability, which is similar to the process capability, but runs without control interventions after the machine is properly set. The period of the machine capability experiment is then the hint for the SPC sampling period. And vice versa. The requirement for the machine capability should prevent the potential process control struggle. There are many other influences which must be taken into account, like the change of the working shift, change of the input material batch, tool change, and everything what is expected to influence the resulting controlled characteristic. Also, the sampling period should be adjusted based on a long-time observation of the data. Here again, there could be no appropriate standard sampling period that could be universally applied to all processes. Setting the period properly is a crucial task, aiming at a good enough specification compliance for the least expense possible. If the inherent variation of the process is too high to be controlled into the specification limits, even with a 100% quality check, there is no chance that switching to the SPC sampling will do the job. Before we start to control the processes based on the SPC sampling, we must make sure that they are capable of being controlled. The two mentioned aspects are not disconnected. They must complement each other. All observations in the sample should be acquired at one time. This is the time in which we want to decide on a potential control intervention. If the sample acquisition is distributed over a period of time from the last sample, the observed properties may no longer be valid or may be completely misleading. For this reason, the moving types of charts are not very efficient. Besides the actual process control, the data collected during the SPC sampling can be used for a number of other purposes. They range from the optimization of process parameters in the long run, comparing different production lines, machine nests, or even individual cavities in the molding press, to predicting the efficiency of the process and determining an appropriate preventive maintenance tasks. The data collected is also priceless for the R&D and engineering, both of the manufacturing technology and of the manufactured product. The engineering can optimize the specification parameters when it is known which dimensions are easier and which are more difficult to control. And last but not least, the consistency of production is important to the future reliability behavior, so it is needless to say how useful it is when it comes to safety or warranty recalls. The biggest conceptual difference between the process capability and the SPC is that the SPC is specific for every process, while the capability can be generalized. The controlling techniques will be different for machining and for welding. They will have to use individualized sampling sizes and periods. The process capability, on the other hand, will show if all this had the desired effect, regardless of the process-specific tricks, just by comparing the outcome to the specification.